Isaiah was clearly a more sensational encounter with God than probably have experienced on any given Sunday in this sanctuary?
I bet.
Our perceptions of the Lord are usually on a level of quiet stirrings, not thundering spectacles. And yet we can't dismiss the experience of the prophet Isaiah, a man who grasped new dimensions of God's power and purity and grace and love through this overload of sensory perceptions that day. Our contemporary problem, I think, is not that we grasp too much of God, but that we experience too little of God. In much of America today, God is seen as marching in lockstep with our political parties and with our national, in quotation marks, interests. God is understood to desire our prosperity and to support, in the words of the prayer of Jabez, the enlargement of our territories. God is perceived as a calming presence, maybe, a supportive friend, a healing helper, all of which really kind of work to maintain the status quo. Now, don't get me wrong. There surely may be some degree of truth in these characterizations, but they're far from the whole truth. They certainly don't come anywhere near matching the experience of Isaiah in that moment of synesthesia. With his sensory perceptions racing on overdrive, Isaiah sees the Lord who is holy and high and lifted up and mighty on a throne. God is far above our political parties and much more pure and perfect than any of our human institutions. The one true God cannot be shoehorned into a particular earthly program, or forced to get in line with our personal or national interests. In fact, that movement is completely antithetical. We need to be getting ourselves in line with God, not trying to get God in line with us. And for that to happen, we need to have a synesthetic experience of God, one that may be baffling, but blessed at the same moment, perplexing, but powerful. For example, Isaiah's experience points us to the triune God on this Trinity Sunday. His threefold holy, holy, holy anthem of praise has traditionally been regarded as a theological marker of the triune nature of God. A synesthetic approach to understand God's threeness might be to see God as a divine community of persons. This is actually an understanding argued by theologian Shirley Guthrie, and it preserves our perception of a single God, but in this case, God is one single community of persons. Within this community, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit work together to do the work of creation, redemption, and sanctification. Within the community, God can show both almighty power and suffering love, can reveal grace and truth in Jesus Christ, and offer inspiration and new life in the person of the Holy Spirit. This view of God also expands our understanding of what it means to be the church today. If God is a community, united in mutual love and shared purpose, then we too can be a cohesive community. If God's community is creative, that is our call as well. If God's community is full of grace and truth, if it offers inspiration, liberation, and transformation, then can you and I rest comfortable in doing any less than that? When we enter God's presence, we not only experience a community of persons, but we also encounter a God of grace, Isaiah's immediate, almost knee-jerk first response to his vision of God is, "Woe is me. I am lost because I am unclean. And yet I live among unclean people. And yet I have seen the face of God. Works for me. Truth for me." But rather than being obliterated by a lightning bolt, Isaiah was given a taste of burning coal of absolution. Your guilt has departed. Your sin is blotted out. How often do you crave to hear those very words in your own heart and soul? The progression is clear. Isaiah saw God, "My eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." And then he saw himself, "Woe is me, for I'm a man of unclean lips." And then he received the forgiveness, the absolution. The journey to spiritual wholeness is a multi-sensory one. When we see God, we cannot help but see ourselves. In our cry for deliverance, a God of grace touches our hearts with coals of love and forgiveness, and we're never the same again, are we? But notice that the experience doesn't end there. Doesn't end with, "Oh, goody goody, unclean." Forgiveness sets us up for service. The voice of the Lord called to Isaiah, "Whom shall I send? Who will go for us?" And Isaiah said, "Here I am, send me." Isaiah knew instinctively that forgiveness freed him to go in a new direction. Not to return to his former ways with a new skin on, but convinced that new life was given to him so that he could serve God. And in doing that, he offered to go in whatever direction God would send him. It wasn't, "Okay, I'll go if you stay over here, but that's the watch over there. Here I am, send me." And he became one of the greatest prophets, speaking God's words to a troubled, corrupt, and sinful society. What do you think God has forgiven you to do? What is it that God is calling you to do or go? The world still needs prophets. The world still needs courageous souls willing to deliver the message, "Thus says the Lord," to a society that is quick to block out divine words, or even worse, to prostitute them and to abuse them. But perhaps even more desperately, the world needs people of vision and energy and integrity in every single field of work performed today. So, be a banker with compassion. Be a salesperson with Christian vision. Be a teacher with a sense of discipleship. Let selflessness mark your work within corporate America or wherever you work, by living words of inclusion and acceptance within your classrooms. Live it out. Now, these qualities may not seem as obvious or predictable a fit, but that's synesthesia. That's the expansion of perception that opens us up to God and to God's will for us. The challenge for every single one of us is to practice synesthesia spirituality. When you have a vision of God, you cannot not do something. Painters with a vision paint. Composers compose. Poets poet. You didn't know that was a word, did you? tell and show and tell. That's what we do. That's what this cross set in our midst is all about. It's what we have been forgiven, my friends, in order to do. And so go and do. Amen.